we call upon the next speaker, Mr. Gopal Amin. Once again, the story of starting really small and multiple times 10x growth over an 18-year journey. Their company, SLK Global, they are into financial services and BPO services with more than 5,000 people in Pune, Bangalore, Kolhapur, Manila, and US. Gopal and his brother, they have built this company and truly believe in world class in Pune. According to Gopal, world class in Pune is about having a mindset of being able to think best in the world and still doing it peacefully. Now, I've known also Gopal also for quite a few years, and what is really inspiring about Gopal is that apart from being able to be world class in his business, he also believes in making time for personal hobbies and passions. Gopal is a 3-time national windsurfing winner. And windsurfing is not an easy sport. In spite of his grueling international travel, Gopal manages to maintain a really tough physical fitness routine. So without any further delay, let's call upon the stage Gopal Amin.
Hi everyone, good afternoon. Glad to be here. Thank you, Aditya, Geeta, for inviting me, and thanks to all of you for attending. I'd like to first start out with something very passionate that I am about, is brand and names and things like that. So while this is the SME Conclave, right, something to do with SMEs, I'm a very big critic of this name. And that's one of the first things we decided when we started our company. We started about in the year 2000, sometime in July 2000. I started working from literally my dining room. My brother started working from his dining room in Bangalore. Then we took up a little shop, literally, in Bangalore, where we put up our first offices. And we started doing IT development and BPO work. And at a very early stage of our company, I hated the label small. Okay? So I just want to understand in this group, how many of you considers yourselves to be small? Very good. Oh, you do? Oh, we have one. Okay. I'm very happy to see nobody does yet. You're okay with an association that has labeled you as being small. I think you should change that. Seriously. Do not go with these, you know, small. And I think the government has started this, right? Small scale industry, you can evade taxes by doing stuff like that and all. I think those days are gone. You have to think big. You have to think bold. And there is no limit to how much you can grow. And what a difference you can make. So, although that was not a part of my original presentation, I just wanted to share those thoughts with you. So, you know, from starting in our own homes, we've managed to build a company with a lot of good people, a lot of good customers. We are about 6,000 people now, roughly about little more than 1,000 crores of turnover. We have global presence, so we have offices in Manila, in many, many places in the US. We have 3 centers in India primarily, three cities, Bangalore, Kolhapur, and Pune, and a little bit of operations and offices in Europe. We are basically an IT, BPO, and a financial services products company in the technology and outsourcing space, providing services to banks, financial institutions, mortgage lenders, real estate companies in the US, etc. And credit card, that's another big one, and a little bit of manufacturing companies. We support implementation and integration of ERP systems for manufacturing and supply chain. So I have another question for you. How many books on business do you think are published in the US? Something is wrong, sorry. How many books on business do you think are published in the US? Shilpa, would you like to move there? They will see better, I think. Can you see the screen? Yeah? Okay. How many books on business? Any guesses? Come on, how many people read business books? Let's find that out. 1, 2. So, quite a few. Okay, but you're putting your hands up a little skeptically. I'm beginning to. This is not a trick question. Come on, how many people read business books? put it up with pride. I mean, there's nothing wrong in that. Okay, so quite a few, right? And so how many business books are published in the US?
1 million.
1 million? No, books, yeah. Not total number of books, titles. 100? Okay. How many? 50,000, you said. You're close in that scale. No, it's 11,000. Okay, 11,000 business books being published in the US every year. So that's a lot of books. Now, can you answer the next question? How many business books are read by me each year? No, come on. Yeah, you're right. So I don't read any business books. Okay, I'm basically a Gujarati. So we get our business education on the dining table. Most Gujaratis will get Gujaratis, Marwadis, Sindhis, Boris, who else is that? Punjabis. We get our business education in the family, in the dining room. But there is a source of learning I have. So I'd like to share that with you. And as you know, entrepreneurs, we have to have sources of learning. There is no doubt about it. We would not have built what we have built without, you know, getting inputs from other people. We are not that creative to come up with what's the next big thing we have to solve, or what the solution for the next big problem we have in our lives or for our companies without inputs from outside. So the way I learn is I learn through YouTube, and somebody referred to, you know, Google being the organizer for the world's information. So that's definitely one of my, actually the primary source of information is YouTube. And I want to share this with you because you're all very busy people. And what I found was I'd pick up business books, I would start reading them, I would come to the third page and I'd get bored of the book because they talk a lot of nonsense. You know, the message is only about 2 or 3 pages, but the guy has to justify his $11. So he writes a lot of examples and writes a lot of anecdotes and, you know, 100, 200 pages. So what I started doing was to understand what I need to do in my business, because we started out really small. But we have a vision of, you know, we want to be big and we want to do great things, all that. So I started reading books by Ellie Goldratt, not reading books, watching videos. So I know these are some of the good books that appeal to me. So Ellie Goldratt, Ryan Holiday, Jack Ma, Elon Musk, Ray Dalio. Anybody knows Ray Dalio here? You do, okay, good. So Ray Dalio is the author of a book called Principles. And he's also the world's largest hedge fund owner. Again, gone bankrupt many times, but through a very structured approach on how he handles different kinds of scenarios and situations, he has managed to create the world's largest hedge fund. And then Jeff Bezos, I don't need to introduce you to him. And then Yuval Noah Harari, because Yuval Noah Harari is all about the human being and about anthropology and how human beings interface and societies and communities interface with each other, countries, cultures, etc. So I watch a lot of videos about him. And I do all this video watching when I work out. Like Aditya said, I don't have time. I'm always, half the time I'm out of Pune traveling on some airport, some plane, some car somewhere, on some meeting. So I use my workout time to watch videos on business, and that's how I get my inspiration, I get my problem solved, I figure out how I have to behave with my people, all kinds of stuff I get, what I have to eat, what exercises to do. YouTube is my channel of, you know, lot of information for me. So one of the first things that, I won't go into too much about the story of SLK because it's pretty long, but what I'll do is I'll give you little anecdotes, basis a few of the outstanding quotations that I've, or quotes and sayings from these people who I follow. So one of the most important thing that, and one of the principles we follow in our business is a saying by Ellie Goldratt, who's the author of the book, The Goal. And I'm sure most of you would have read that book. And that is that to make money by increasing net profit, that is the purpose of a business. I know, Shilpi, you disagreed with this to some extent, but this is my view. To make money by increasing net profit while simultaneously increasing return on investment and simultaneously increasing cash flow. So as a business, and there are a few people who I try to mentor on a regular basis, you know, young businessmen, and Eddie's one of them. I am very hard on them on this point, saying you cannot run a business for social purposes. You cannot run a business because I'm passionate about something, or I'm passionate about, you know, I like dogs, so I'm going to start a dog food business. I'm like, sorry, you're not going to start a business because you like dogs. You're not going to start a business on dogs because you like dogs. I disagree with that philosophy, because you have a passion, keep it a hobby. Business is about making money, giving return to your shareholders, giving good service to your customers, keeping your employees happy. You like dogs, have 10 dogs in your house, enjoy them as much as you want. Don't think you can convert that hobby into a business. Many people do it successfully, but I've seen more people fail trying to do that than focusing on their business. Business, according to me, and many of you face this situation, is not about, oh, I got to look out for that old guy, he's been with me for 20 years. Therefore, I'm going to keep him in the company, because what's he going to do if he goes out? That's not my problem. And really, guys, that is not a business's problem. You are there to, you know, make a return for your shareholder, take care of your company, take care of your employees, take care of your customers. How to take care of this guy who's been with you for 20 years is a different problem. Earmark some money for him, send him for training programs, find him another job, do whatever you want. But don't let deadwood remain in your business. Same thing with products that aren't making money for you. If they're not making money for you, do not have emotional attachments when it comes to non-profitable parts of your business. That's my brief but very clear message, and I follow this to the T. My brother followed this to the T in our business. People may call it ruthlessness, people may call it, you know, you don't have a heart, this, that. But the point is, I have a responsibility to certain people. I will meet that responsibility. Take care of all our other responsibilities in a different way, not through the business. The next one I want to talk about, and this has happened to us a lot, because we started 18 years ago, sorry, on the previous one, we started 18 years ago. There did come times in our journey when, let's say, we had a manager who had been with us from day one. He left his previous job, joined us, but then he got too old and he wasn't adding value. We've asked such people to go. We've taken care of them in a different way, give them a big, you know, golden parachute, find jobs for their kids, bring them into the company, whatever. But we've always kept our business very, very lean and very, very focused towards value-adding people. The other quote that I use and I refer to a lot is this one. The obstacle in the path becomes the path. Never forget, within every obstacle is an opportunity to improve our condition. How many of you have heard of Ryan Holiday? You have, yesterday also you had. You have too, right? So he's the author of a book called Obstacle is the Way. This is a book by, it's the writings by one of the greatest Roman emperors called Marcus Aurelius. Marcus Aurelius was one of the last great emperors of Rome, and after him really the decline of Rome started. And he had a lot of, he was a philosopher, he believed in Stoicism, and he wrote a lot about how at any important juncture in your life, if you look back into your lives too, you will find that it was one obstacle or the other that made you change your path or change your direction or overcome an obstacle that actually gave you more progress in the future. So the birth of SLK. So SLK was born because both my brother and I, who were at that time working in a family business, ran into a little bit of disagreements with our family members. It was a very painful time for us. It was a very difficult time for us. We were literally out on the road with no job overnight. But optimists as we are, we figured out that, you know, we can't let that continue to be the situation. And so we said, chalo, let's get into offshore outsourcing. This is back in 2000 when it was still a new concept. And we made the right moves, and it's turned out to be a good decision. We've been successful. An example of how, you know, an obstacle really converted itself, or we converted an obstacle into a very nice situation for us. The same thing happened after we started our companies 2-3 years ago. One of our largest clients got acquired, and this was close to 30% of our revenue. And here we are having just enough revenues to make, you know, ends meet. And 30% of your revenues are going to disappear. So because they got acquired by another large company. So panic situation. But with that situation came a very, very nice thing, because we went and talked to that new company that acquired our customer and said, guys, you know, we are so and so, why don't you give us more work? And fortunately for us, they liked our pitch, they liked what we were selling. And the one of my old colleagues is sitting here, Prakash, knows about all this. They started doing work with us, and that the company that got acquired, sorry, the company that was the acquirer ended up giving us 10 times the amount of work that the previous company was giving us, and gave us a whole new vertical to put up, which is still close to about 10% of our revenues now. So just a lesson, you'll meet a lot of hurdles. And I'll tell you the flip side of this. If you're not seeing hurdles in your business, you're not doing enough. So you need to create your hurdles. You need to create those crazy goals for your business if you want to keep growing and you want to keep being successful. The third slide I want to talk about is never give up. So this is from Jack Ma. Today is hard, tomorrow will be worse, but the day after tomorrow will be sunshine. If you give up tomorrow, you will never see the sunshine. So there's been many examples, and Smart Prop, that's one of our products. By the way, Namita is not here, but I want to give her credit for us transforming from being a BPO, which is like a, you know, a contract manufacturer, into a products company. So earlier, we used to only do work which our clients would specify for us. It was banking transaction, or it was a mortgage related back office transaction. But Namita and me are good friends, and after hearing Satish uncle's story, I got very inspired, and I said, why can't we do the same thing in financial services for the US market? So today, after about, you know, 6-7 years of journey, we have a product called Smart Prop, which has been in the US market for about 3-4 years. It's one of the leading products for the mortgage and the real estate industry. It's like our Sat Bara, sort of, you know, for the US market. But got inspiration from Namita and started it. It was a very long journey, because again, 3-4 years to develop this product. Like that, we have another mystery product, would have labeled as mystery product X, which we haven't launched yet. Again, 4-5 years in the making. Lot of your, you know, cash flows go into investing into these new products, but you have to do it, because I want to see the sunshine, you know, day after tomorrow. So, and it's also helps you create a brand. So I'm going to ask you another question. What's the GDP of the US? I'm sure this group knows. The GDP of the US? $20 trillion? Yeah, in that range. You're close. What's the GDP of China? 14. Very good. What's the market capitalization of the US? NASDAQ or Wall Street, anybody know? 26 trillion. And Chinese companies? Yeah, it's like, it's much, much less. It's like less than 5. Now, why am I asking you this? Now, I'm going to ask you another question. Give me 5 Chinese brand names. Lenovo. Okay, 1. Huawei. Alibaba, WeChat, OnePlus, and you basically stop, right? Now give me 10 American brand names. I don't want your answer, because you'll give me 100. My point is, for each of your companies, and we went through the same transition, is your brand recognized in your target segment and in your customer segment? And we realized this about 5-6 years ago. And I attended a course, a small 2-day course at Oxford, because I don't like to go to training programs either. I somehow got a free invite somewhere, so I went. But I realized this example about the Chinese stock market, American stock market, American brand names versus Chinese brand names was given to me, and I realized that my brand is not recognized in my market because we are a contract manufacturer. So we had to have our own products. And I'm sure there's a lot of contract manufacturers sitting here. How many of you are contract manufacturers? But you don't have your own product. You have your own company, but your designs and manufacturing processes, etc., come from your OE. Are there companies like that here? Yeah, so some of you. Many of you seem like you already have your own products and your own designs. But we went through that transition and it's helped out a lot. So my suggestion is also that you have to design your own products, have your own brand in the market for long-term sustainability. And the next quote here is, when something is important enough, you do it even if the odds are not in your favor. And that's the story about the mystery product X. This is something which the industry is really, really needing, or the banking industry in the US. This is a very risky product, very, very high capital intensive from our company's side, but I am backing it, many of my colleagues are backing it, our customers are backing it, because nobody else in the world is doing this for them. So again, coming, that's why I follow Elon Musk a lot. Who else would have thought of sending people to Mars? He just thinks it's important to do whatever it costs. He's not worried about if it makes him money or not right now. Eventually, I'm sure he will be. Or he keeps finding people who fund him. But to me, that's very important as well. And then the next one is from Ray Dalio. Rather than thinking I'm right, I started to ask myself, how do I know I am right? So in this journey of transformation and growth for our companies, I'm always trying to figure out whether the decisions I take, the decisions and the direction that our company is moving in, is it right or wrong? And so we've put in a whole mechanism, and my partner in this crime is sitting here, Vimal Rajan, he's my executive assistant. So we've put in this thing called the business activity management system across SLK, where we sit and we track all kinds of minutest details. We want to know how many, you know, what is our rate of invoicing every hour, every day, every month, every week? What are the trends that are happening in terms of attrition or in terms of quality or in terms of receivables or in terms of invoicing? We like to keep track of everything. So that when we make a decision, I want to know what is the lag between, so you make a decision because you intend to see some change, right? You make a decision to start, let's say you want to bring your days outstanding down. So you make some changes in your ERP system, you make some changes in your invoicing system, in your communication system with clients, in how you, you know, how your bank wire transfers are done, etc. But once you've made those changes, it's very important to know whether your decision worked or not. And therefore, we put in this business activity management system, which has a lot of pieces to it, so that right from the time we make the decision, we want to know, is it working or not? Because if it's not working, either we go and tweak that system to make sure that it gives the result that we want, or if it's not working, let's scrap those old changes, because there's no point in falling in love with a system you created which is not giving you any result. So I love Ray Dalio's thinking on this, in this respect. I like to follow it myself, and it's given us a lot of rich dividends. The last one is about, if you do build a great experience, customers tell each other about it. And Mr. Salian talked about that when you talked about the Korean, you know, the some oil sump or something. It's so true. So, at many of our customers, there's this phrase called, let's SLK it. Because you start out an offshore outsourcing relationship with tons of resistance. It's the hardest thing to do, to convince an American bank to outsource to India. But we've seen that with consistent good quality, consistent good pricing, consistent good service levels, communication, etc., very high standards of security, we find that you get one area, 10 more areas come to you on their own without you even having to ask them. That's because they start talking amongst themselves that, hey, you have a problem with service level on that process, you know, I'm going to send you the number of a vendor, you talk to them, they'll solve it for you. So we are not doing a lot of the cross-selling within our customers, but customers are doing it for us. And no better example than Amazon. There's very few people who go to the Amazon website and come back with a bad experience. In fact, there's many people who will say, wow, it was so easy to shop on Amazon, and tell their friends and colleagues and family about it. So I like to follow Jeff Bezos also, because I love his execution, speed of execution, his, you know, boundless scope. I mean, Amazon is ready to sell anything. There's no limits in that guy's mind. He's ready to send rockets into space. So I like that. The last message, I've not been watching my time, but I have 2 more minutes, is don't take yourself too seriously. We are all businessmen. I know there's a lot of pressure on customer deliveries and money and bank account and, you know, I have to pay this loan and EMI and all that. But know when to laugh at yourself. Find a way to laugh at obstacles and inevitably present that are going to inevitably present themselves in front of you. So I make sure that I follow my passion, and I've been doing windsurfing for the last, 30, 35 years. I continue to do it. I have my children who do it with me. I have a small windsurfing training place I've started off in Pauna, because work will go on. I'm going to get old one day, stop working, and I'm going to have something to do. And need something to detox my brain when I'm at work or de-stress. So I windsurf regularly, and can't go wrong with Halle Berry's photograph on the slide. So thank you all. I hope that was useful.
Thank you so much, Gopal. And I love the way he says, I'm going to get old one day. Let's see when that day comes. Really beautiful messages, boundless enthusiasm, and you can see the whole journey of moving from a services company to a product company. And I think that's something that is, the time has come for India, not just world class in Pune. So thank you so much, Gopal. I'm going to request Mr. Deepak Karandikar, Vice President of MCCI, to please come up. A little bit of exercise, sir, for you, and present Gopal with Crash.